with all due respect, like I say, Joshi has written the Lovecraft biography. It's an incredible piece of work.
Oh, I mean, the research he put in there.
Yeah,
he's very talented. He knows what he's talking about. And he's very, very well versed in weird fiction of the time and everything.
But he has his limits.
Yes.
One of his limits is that he's good at, you know, this happened then, this happened when, and such a time. When it comes to interpreting the Lovecraft stories themselves, he's usually full of, I don't know, what's those words I can't use again, Tony Jones? Yes, he's full of, let's just say, misguided opinions about the content, the meaning of these Lovecraft stories.
Yes. Well, he didn't actually know, nobody knew Lovecraft when he was writing or anything, and a lot of people take how they know Lovecraft through his letters,
right,
and they read Lovecraft's letters, but if you like, if Lovecraft is being sarcastic or saying a joke or anything, you don't get the inflection in the letter.
Exactly, and it strikes me that S.T. Joshi is a particularly humorless person. That's the impression I get from his writings. Mm. He's also a person who has his philosophical view of life, and he will take the work of the authors he studies and bend them to his point of view. I mean, he accuses August Derleth. Now, I know I'm dropping names, a lot of names here, but I'm assuming that a lot of our listeners of the Haunted Cabaret are familiar with H.P. Lovecraft, you know, a lot of these authors of his circle.
Yeah, August Derleth was a writer back in the Weird Tales days in the 1920s and 30s.
Right.
And what he did after Lovecraft passed away, he enjoyed Lovecraft's work so much, he didn't want it to fall by the wayside, and he created Arkham House specifically to put the works of H.P. Lovecraft out there.
Which he did. And August Derleth is the publisher, as Jim just said, for bringing Lovecraft before a worldwide audience.
Yes.
If it hadn't been for August Derleth publishing Lovecraft's work, Lovecraft would have been as lost as all those other authors of Weird Tales.
Yeah, eventually somebody would have found them, but it would have taken a lot
more. It might not have happened in the same way.
Right.
Because this was single-minded determination on the part of Derleth.
Yes.
And his friend Donald Wandry.
Right, yes, it was.
Yeah. And getting back to S.T. Joshi, Joshi criticizes August Derleth for misinterpreting Lovecraft's work and putting his own spin on
the Cthulhu mythos.
On the Cthulhu mythos, exactly. Joshi does it just as bad.
Mm-hmm.
Joshi, in other words, when Joshi is an atheist, that's the first problem. Mm-hmm. Lovecraft was a materialist, but Lovecraft was also a mystic, in the opinion of your humble host of the Haunted Cabaret. Lovecraft was a guy who would explore ancient towns, and he said he was never in such contact with the universe and with the past and with bigger things as when he was paraphrasing, of course, as when he was exploring these ancient towns. That's a mystic. That's not, you know, he was an avowed materialist. But one thing, now let me say to our listeners right now that this room is full of entertainers. Okay, I'm your talk show host. I do some writing, I do some music. We have across from me an evil clown. Jim here is a writer,
an editor,
a publisher. Tony Jones, our producer, also in the entertainment business, radio, music, publishing. The one thing we all have in common is that none of us tell the truth. We're all a bunch of liars, okay?
That's what writers do.
That's what writers do. It has never occurred to anybody yet, I don't think. If it has, I apologize to the person it occurred to. H.P. Lovecraft was one of the best people ever at constructing a public persona. Okay. S.T. Joshi takes every word Lovecraft stated in his letters, every word he wrote, as the reflection of Lovecraft's philosophy of life. That is the biggest mistake that a scholar of any writer, musician, painter, you can't do that. Creative people are liars. I mean, I wish, you know, more serious-minded scholars would understand that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if any of my listeners take nothing else from this show, understand that. I mean, I have not said a single word of truth since I first picked up a guitar, since I first put pen to paper, and since I first started this show. I'm just nice enough to warn you periodically that everything we do on this and say on this show is for entertainment purposes only. Okay, that goes for Lovecraft's work, that goes for Jim's work, all of us. Okay, you cannot take any of us at face value. Please get that through your head, Mr. Joshi. Now, having gotten as serious as I'm ever going to get on this program.
I'm getting ready to jump boat. I'm going right out this window. Things are getting too serious over here.
We're going to recover really, really, really quick. The best way to recover is by playing something by, let's say, how about the sword? Let's do a Burial's Blade here on the Haunted Cabaret on Rhode Island Free Radio. All right, that was Burial's Blade by the band The Sword. I guess you'd say that's a power metal band, you know, just to show how open-minded I am. You know, it's not always death metal here. It's not always classic metal here. It's not always black metal here. I'll go for the power metal as much as I sometimes say I despise it, you know, from time to time. I think I've finished saying how much I despise the attitude of SD Joshi. So let's change the subject to, we mentioned your publishing efforts. Yes. What's the name of, you know, let's put it out there. What's the name of your company and
the name of
how do we reach you and all that important stuff before sure. We...
The name of my publishing company is Fenham Publishing. Because of my Rhode Island accent, I'll spell it for you. It's F-E-N-H-A-M Publishing. And you can reach me at www.fenhampublishing.com. And I'm also on Facebook. If you go to Facebook, go to Fenham Publishing, you can like the page if you want. But like I said, I had the three books out now. I have one book about H.P. Lovecraft in my grandparents' words. And I have two short story collections of my grandfather's.
Okay. Do you have any plans to, kind of like August Derleth did, you know, like start off with the one main subject?
Yeah.
And then do you have any plans to publish other authors or get into
further
afield?
Yeah, eventually I will. But I think 90% of getting a book out there is marketing.
Right.
So I could just put a book out from anybody, but I don't want to fall flat and not be able to market and get behind them. So I want to make sure I'm pretty well established with something I'm on my way to do before I take on other authors and everything. But I will eventually. So,
right.
Yes.
Yeah, that just shows planning ahead. I mean, in other words, and I see it all too often.
Yeah.
Yeah, the book goes out there. I mean, unless is it fair to say, unless you're a, I guess, what would you say, brand author?
Yeah, unless you're an established author, then, you know, you have to create a following and you have to create buzz about you and everything. Right. And that's a lot of work. So.
And part of the work is, well, Chuckles, you know all about this. Chuckles the Clown is a brand in itself. Most of the, it's not an easy, quick fix to put the word out there, right? It's, you know, it's a lot of grassroots.
Basically, you cannot sit behind a television or a computer screen and say, woe is me. You got to get off your ass and do stuff. That's what it comes down to.
Yeah, I mean, my favorite story is a musician we know who shall remain nameless. He was finally persuaded to put some of his music on the internet. And a few weeks later, you know, our producer Tony Jones was talking to him. And, yeah, Tony, I put a few of my songs online and nothing happened. Yeah, it doesn't end there. That's where it begins.
It begins when you have to promote yourself. And with my grandfather's stories and my publishing company, I've been going to a lot of different conventions.
Right.
Comic conventions, horror conventions, and different shows and everything like that.
Right. You were even brave enough. I remember running into you at the Scituate Art Festival, yes, where they, for some diabolically evil reason, had stashed you and the other authors behind the public library,
yes,
on a side street in, yes, a, on the furthest end of a parking lot.
Yes.
Well, that's because the clam cakes are very important. Those got to be out there in front.
But people did find us too, though. And they had the clam cakes. After, yeah, they got the clam cakes, they went to find us. But I have done like different craft shows and things like that. So I try and get out to a good mix.
Now, are you seeing results?
Yes, I have. Yeah.
Okay,
yes.
Because a lot of people, that's what will happen is, you know, I guess there's a lack of stick-to-itness these days. I mean, whether it's musicians, authors, everybody. Oh, I did this and I did this and nothing happened. And they're talking about a three-week span of time. And they're wondering why nothing happened.
We have, when you go to the shows, and I think Chuckles even said that, you have to engage the people. You have to tell them. Because, you know, sometimes I've gone to shows and some authors are there or some people are there and they just sit behind the table. And they don't engage the people. And people will come up. But you need to let them know,
right,
what you have to offer.
Right, and I know exactly where of you speak, because the author will sit, not only will he or she sit behind the table, but the body language is actively, leave me the F alone.
Yeah. Yeah,
I not want to talk to you, but, and yeah, and Chuckles, you see that we see, Rock and Shock, and it's not just authors, it's musicians,
celebrities.
It's artists, celebrities.
It's not just the author.
Set behind there with a tablet talking to their friend when you're trying to get an autograph or talk to them about your favorite line or whatnot, and they could care less, they're brushing you off. Now, I know, and your grandfather, of all people, knows this as well as you do as far as pushing himself, because that man was in almost everything. Not only did he do books, worked with Houdini, but
he was a composer. He
composer was of lullabies, right?
Lullabies. And other things too. He produced quite a bit of sheet music that I found.
So he my
mind reels and is terrified at the lyrical content of these lullabies.
Well,
The man who wrote The Love Dead wrote lullabies.
Yeah, but he was so versatile that
he
was versatile. And he was also, back in the day, he was a booking agent for the vaudeville shows back in Providence and Connecticut and Massachusetts. He took a lot of the movie theaters, like the Lowe's and the Face Theater. They had magicians, comedians, and everything, and he was a booking agent.
So I go on record. I ask you this every time. You think you would have booked the Evil Clown?
I think he would have.
You think the eating out of the diaper thing would have been right up his hand?
I don't know. That's what you asked.
Maybe eating the organs, maybe, but I don't know about the diaper. Yeah. I mean, the man, you know, Ciametti was a gentleman, as was Lovecraft. You know, they were weird, they were twisted, but they still maintained some sense of decorum, unlike the Evil Clown.
Oh, well, thank you.
All right. With that, let's go to a band that also has no sense of decorum, based on their album art and music itself. How about the Melvins? Let's go with Going Blind here on the Haunted Cabaret, Rhode Island Radio.